think it's important with a review like this to tell people your favourite dad joke. And my favourite dad joke of all time is, what is E.T. short for? Well, he's got little legs. And that is the quality content you've come to expect. And we all know about this game, right? The one playing right on the screen at the moment, even though most of us have never even played it. It might be the most notorious game of all time, after all. And we all know the story about it, at least I'm presuming so, about Atari's overreach, about poor old Howard Scott Warshaw having just 5 weeks to develop the E.T. game, about its part in the US video game crash of 1983, and of course about those millions of unsold cartridges buried in the desert of New Mexico. And if you didn't, well, that story has been covered in depth by numerous sources, from Netflix's High Score documentary to the AVGN movie to numerous quality YouTube videos on the subject and a ton of online articles. I'm not here to rehash that old ground. I'm here to hash new ground. Is hashing a thing you can do? Anyway, I'm hashing. Allow me to hash. And that new ground is what you might not know. And what you might not know is, in 2001 and 2002, a now defunct company called New Kid Co. released 5 E.T. titles across various formats. 5! And not only that, they were planning on releasing another 3! Did New Kid Co. not see what happened in 1983? No wonder they went out of business a few years later, eh? Did they not notice that one E.T. game nearly took down the entire industry? I mean, it wasn't that, but you know what I mean. And I know it sounds like I'm blaming E.T. himself, although, really, we should never really normalise a creepy, wrinkly new dude that hangs around with children. It's not right. Now, we don't really need to cover this because I'm sure you're aware of E.T. the Extraterrestrial. But because it is a 40-year-old movie, let's just have a look at the plot line of that. E.T. was the tale of a boy, Elliot, who befriends a stranded alien botanist with Jesus powers, and their combined efforts to make contact with the homesick, stumpy-legged fella's people so he can go home because he's sick of Earth. I know the feeling. What I can never get, though, was that they were a very advanced interstellar race. How can they not remember, one, they've left him, and two, remember where they've left him? Can they not just swoop back to the planet and just see if he's there? Did someone not look around the ship and go, oh, E.T. was here a minute ago. Oh, wait a minute, we've only been to that planet. Shall we go back and get him? Even the parents in Home Alone quickly figured out where they left Macaulay Culkin. Anyway, it was a huge success because it's more of that Steven Spielberg genius magic. And it, you know what, I like it because it's got links to Star Wars. I actually used to think it was a Star Wars movie because, you know what, it had Yoda in it, didn't it? And then, of course, he appeared in The Phantom Menace, E.T. did, didn't he? In the little corner there. And of course, another reason I like it is because Stone Cold E.T. is ridiculous and it always makes me laugh.
And that's the bottom line.
So what about these 2000s era E.T. games then? And let me just say that New Kid Co. weren't the only games company up to 20th anniversary E.T. games shenanigans either. You see, Ubisoft also released a pair of activity games based around E.T. in 2002 called E.T. Away From Home and E.T. Phone Home Adventure. I'm not covering those though because, you know what, I've got enough stretched neck outer-worldly shithousery to deal with these New Kid Co. games. So let's begin with the Game Boy Advance and E.T. the Extraterrestrial, developed by Fluid Studios, who also did the Game Boy Advance version of Worms World Party and Army Men Air Combat on the Game Boy Color. E.T. follows the plot of the movie with a variety of mini-games punctuating the main maze exploration meat of the game. On most levels, you'll be steering E.T. about the environment, but at times you'll be cast into the red hoodie of young Elliot as he tries to bust his Brodo-Asogian buddy out of his incarceration by the feds. Sometimes you'll be controlling both with a head-over-heels-esque character swap button, and other levels will see you building a telecoms device in a confusing and unwieldy puzzle game. But at least the Speak and Spell makes an appearance for us 80s toy nostalgia aficionados. The last level has you controlling the movie's most iconic scene, but rather than the triumphant exhilaration of escape that it conveys in the movie, it's an absolute slog as various cops, scientists and feds lean out of the windows and pelt the poor intercosmic duo down, all played out against a gradient skybox that would make an Amiga owner blush with excitement. What becomes immediately evident when you play this game is that it is rushed Eurojank. The feeling of the Eurojank is strong in the main body of the game. The energy bar on the screen is a representation of ET rotating when he takes a hit, and I dare you to try and figure out how this works. I have no idea how much energy ET has at any one time. If they'd taken more due care and attention with the game, they might have come up with a better representation of a health bar. Perhaps ET could turn white like a white dog turd, like he does in the film. Instead, we get this weird rotating representation of ET that makes no sense at all. The level designs are equally really poor, and the enemies are a collection of toys, wildlife, and human authority figures dressed in a series of both film-themic costumes and not-so-film-themic costumes, because why is that guy wearing snow camo? And they all look like Diego Maradona on a night out with the Colombian marching powder. It controls really stiffly, and the pair of controllable characters have a weird inertia that feels, well, alien to move about with. It's poor stuff, really, living on the reputation of one of the best movies of the late 20th century, and I give it the thumbs down. IGN described the game as muddled, difficult, and unforgiving, and gave E.T. the Extraterrestrial on the Game Boy Advance 35%. And they're bloody well right. Moving on, and E.T. the Interplanetary Mission, and that was released on the PlayStation and Windows and developed by Santa Cruz Games, a company with a history of putting together licensed games such as games based on Superman and Shark Tale. Who remembers Shark Tale? None of you. Interplanetary Mission is set after the events of the movie, as E.T. makes several stops off on his way home to pick rare plant specimens on a variety of different alien planets. I personally think he should have head home because that's what he was making all the fuss about in the film. Maybe he just didn't really like Elliot at all and just wanted to leave the needy little kid back on planet Earth. Presented from an isometric viewpoint, the various species that inhabit the strange lands are miffed that E.T. has shown up to nick their fauna, and they've decided that he should bog off, and they will attack him by any means necessary to get him off their ruddy planet. You have to evade them as you scoop up their greenery while using your telekinesis powers to block their path and unblock yours to the exit. Even though E.T. has annoyed these intergalactic folk with his plant-based heist, he actually does them a bit of a solid, as while he's nabbing some of their roughage, he also helps heal the plants using his magic healing dildo finger that we all know and love, especially your mum. Interplanetary Mission is a simple, straightforward and very linear adventure. It moves at a fair old pace, but it's short, just like the wrinkled little fella himself. E.T. charges about like a coward with his bored, monotonous voice. Wait, am I E.T.? And he does this in a fairly competent, if extremely unspectacular game. It's not going to be in anyone's top 100 games on the PlayStation system, but it's hardly likely to haunt the lower echelons either. It is at best described as ho-hum. On to the Game Boy Color now, which had the lion's share of the E.T. game goodness. E.T. and the Cosmic Garden has you as E.T. doing his day job, looking after plants. This is the world building that Spielberg didn't give us, the hairy chinned hack. You travel across six planets nurturing various rare plants for your spaceship's greenhouse by doing the usual plant tending stuff of watering, planting seeds, and giving them a healthy chunk of manure on their roots. Now, as E.T. is nude and has no bag with him, I guess we have our first Game Boy Color E.T. shitting simulator. You also have to protect the plants from critters, like giant space wasps, and even worse, this huge, well-drawn slug, which the help menu describes as your friend. A friend. I tell you what, a friend wouldn't do this. Anyway, it's a light edutainment title for kids about responsibility, which is a bit more fun for nippers than looking after an actual plant, but not by that much. Escape from Earth is quietly a bit of a corker. Once again, set during the events of the movie, E.T. and Elliot have to cycle between 10 environments around Elliot's hometown looking for transmitter parts so E.T. can get home and not have his stomach open on a cold slab in Area 51. Riding over the dots enters a series of Chips Challenge style puzzle games where using a combination of Elliot and E.T. is the key to success. In the early stages of the game, for example, you may solve a conundrum on how to grab a piece of the transmitter by positioning Elliot in a particular place to stop E.T. from careering past the access point on this slippery ice. Powers can be collected to help E.T. get the singular solution to an issue, and it's a real mind bender at times. As an E.T. license, it's not a brilliant use of the material in terms of being a close license, but it is a really good Chips Challenge style puzzler, and it's probably the best game on this list by quite a distance. It's worth a go. E.T. the Digital Companion was definitely the game I was most looking forward to seeing because it was the most intriguing. What could it be? My thoughts before playing it were that it might be a Tamagotchi-style affair, which it sort of is. Or it might be a game that gives you trivia about the movie, or it might let you play out cool scenes from the movie, again, which it sort of does. But when I did boot it up, E.T. became a very intrusive alien. Ridiculously so. It was a slew of menu screens wanting to know absolutely everything about me. Where I live, my date of birth, what foods I like, my pet's name. I was half expecting to log on to my bank's website and be told that I bought a dildo and an iPad in a shop on Brodo Asogi. I thought the little bugger was trying to hack me and steal my personal information. So what's this all about then? Well, it turns out it's not actually a game at all. It's a personal organiser for 8-year-olds, a Filofax for the busy 6-year-old on the go, somewhere for a 7-year-old to keep all his important Pokemon trading card business contacts. Why does this exist? There are games on here, don't get me wrong. There's an Excitebike style cycling game, which has you dodging obstacles and trying to beat your times. There's a trivia quiz about the film that was a bit harsh to me. I mean, I got 100% of the questions correct, you brown space dick. There's a slider puzzle for those who love being terminally bored, a picture match game for the same people, and a word scramble to cater for those that have already been well catered for in that department. And yes, there is a virtual pet, but you don't look after E.T. because, you know, he can evidently look after himself, what with his data mining prepubescence for their bank details. But instead, you look after this, which is called a flop gopple, which I'm pretty sure is a Pornhub search term. The E.T. Digital Companion is software with no real reason to exist, and so it should be treated as such. Who knows what the final three games would have been from the new Kid Co hype train? but poor sales meant that E.T. returned to the Green Planet on the PlayStation 2, E.T. Search for Dragora on the GameCube and Xbox, and E.T. Solarium Project on the Game Boy Advance, and this is the best image I can find of the box art for this game. Well, those games, well, they will remain as mysterious as their titles. Maybe the extra oomph of the later gen consoles would have given us some better experiences. Maybe. The 30th anniversary in 2012, well, that just saw one game emerge, which was a now defunct iOS game called E.T. The Green Planet, and it showed that lessons were learned from the absolute splurge of games that came out on the 20th anniversary. E.T. games aren't meant to do well. Sorry, E.T. Poor fella. Since 2012, we've only had two appearances from the well-tanned space midget. E.T. had his own Lego Dimension set, which gave you a clutch of levels as well as a little toy to play with. I'm really surprised the Lego Dimension series wasn't more popular than it was. You could be Doctor Who running around the Simpsons house. How was that not popular? The last appearance of the paddle-footed fella came in the form of Pinball Effects 3. There was an add-on for it for several Universal movies such as Back to the Future and, of course, E.T. And that's it, though, so far. Is this the last we will see of E.T. as a game character? Possibly. But if five games can come out all at once, who knows? Bets are off. Five games. Crikey. And five games that none of them are worth phoning home about. Do you see what I did there? I know it's supposed to be writing home, but phoning fits the E.T. thing. Anyway, press your nose against the subscribe button, please. Just a little bit. Just, yeah, like that. Great, thank you. And Kay, thanks. Bye.
And that's the bottom line.